Hello viewers, today we shall be doing part F of the unit 4th, dealing with shares, share capital, members transfer and transmission of the shares. Now let us discuss about the section 81(3). Section 81(3) deals with the issue of convertible debentures or raising of loans with an option to convert them into shares. The scope of the section 81(3) is to issue convertible debentures or loans, or issue debentures or raise loans with an option to subscribe for new shares. The term of issue of such debentures or loans must contain a term regarding conversion of such debentures or loans into shares. Now, there is a difference between issuing the shares in the first instance or converting them later on, a debenture or a loan, into the shares. This is with regard to whenever a company has issued the debentures or loans with an option to convert it into shares, then there are a few compliances which have to be made. These compliances shall be covered in the conditions relating to issue of the debentures with an option to convert them into shares under section 81(3). The first one being that the company must obtain the approval of central government before issue of such shares or loans. However, the approval of central government is not required if the company complies with such rules as may be prescribed by the central government. The third one is that the company has passed a special resolution. However, such a special resolution is not required if debentures are issued to the government or loans are raised from the government. Now, this scenario is that the debentures and loans, when they get converted into shares, they rank equally as members with the right to dividend rather than getting interest on the issue of debentures, which was originally done by the company. Now let us know about the effect of depository system or dematerialization of shares. Dematerialization of share means holding the shares in a DMAT form, that is, not in a physical form but in a digital state. It's equal to holding your money in the bank through the entry in the passbook. So similarly, the shares are not held by the physical certificates, but their issue is notified in the DMAT account which has been opened by the company. According to the section 83, shares shall cease to have a distinct number. Section 41. The beneficial owners specified in the register maintained by the depository shall be deemed to be the member of the company. The name of the beneficial owner has been entered by the depository and he becomes the member of the company automatically. Section 152A. The depository shall be deemed to be the register and index of member and debenture holder. Normally, when the shares are in their physical format, the register of member has to be maintained by the company and all the details of the member regarding the address, number of share held and the face value of the share is mentioned in that register of member. But once they have been dematerialized, then the depository shall be maintaining all these details and a separate register of member shall not be required. Now, few details which have been dealt in the section 130. No share certificate shall be issued to the shareholder when the shares are issued in dematerialized form. Also, where the shares are transferred in dematerialized form, the transferee shall not be issued a share certificate. Again, to recall, the normal procedure for the issue of shares is when the shares have been allotted, then within a period of 3 months of the original issue, the share certificate is given to the members, and when there is a transfer of share, then within 2 months of the transfer deed being lodged, a share certificate is issued to the members. But when the shares have been converted in a dematerialized form, the formality of issuing the share certificate is not required anymore. However, where the shares are required to be issued in dematerialized form, the company shall immediately after the allotment intimate the details of allotment to the depository. Like we have to issue an allotment letter while the shares are issued in physical form, similarly, whenever there is a allotment of shares in the dematerialized form, all the details are given to the members and such an intimation is sent to him. Now, according to the section 108, the provisions relating to production of transfer deed along with the share certificate for effecting the transfer of share does not apply where the shares are held in dematerialized form. In other words, no transfer deed is required to be executed where the shares are held in depository system. All the formalities which were required in the physical holding of the shares, that is lodging the transfer deed along with the original share certificate to the company and then getting it transferred and the fact being noted on the share certificate, all these formalities will now be dispensed with because of the depository system. Hence, no physical shares will be required to be posted to the company. Also, no such transfer deed which has been executed between the transferor and transferee requires to be posted to the company to note the fact of transfer. Another important aspect of the shares is conversion of it into stock. This is dealt under section 94. Stock is a bundle of shares where the shares lose their different identity and they are represented by a value of the stock. So stock means a bundle of shares expressed in a lump sum. It means the aggregate of fully paid up shares of a member merged into one fund. The company cannot make an original issue of stock. Section 94 authorizes a company to convert its fully paid share into a stock. Hence, there could not be any original issue of stock, but when the shares are issued and they become fully paid, they could be converted into stock. Usually, they are traded in marketable lots. It could be in multiples of tens or hundreds of shares. These stocks can also occur in fractions and transfer of the stock can also be done in fractions. Now there are some conditions of issue relating to the issue of the stock. The company is authorized by articles in this behalf, then only the issue of stock can be done. The company has to pass an ordinary resolution and the company has to give a notice to the registrar within 30 days of conversion of shares into the stock. After all these compliances, then the shares will be converted into stock. Now, what shall be the effect of such a conversion? The shares includes stock except where a distinction between stock and shares is expressed or implied. So, we will be dealing with many instances in our daily life when both the terms are used interchangeably, like share trading or stock trading, or stock market or share market. So these terms are mostly used interchangeably, except when a distinction between the two can be made out. The register of members shall show the amount of stock which has been held by the member instead of the shares previously held by each members. So, when the shares have been converted into stock, then the different distinctive shares which had been issued to the members, that entry shall be replaced by the issuing of the stocks which has been done to the members. Therefore, the details of the previously held shares shall be replacing the details of the stock held by the members. Then is the conversion of shares or stock does not affect in any way the rights of the members. That means they can exercise their voting rights and right to dividend similarly they had been doing for the shares. The stock can be transferred in the same way as the shares can be transferred with the only difference that the stock can be transferred in fractions also. The company shall comply with the same conditions to reconvert the stock into shares. So, it is a reversible process. A company which has already converted the shares into stock can also reconvert the stock back into shares. Also, the shares in stocks can be transferred in the same manner as they had been doing it for the shares. Now let us know the points of distinction between the stocks and the shares. The first is the nature. The shares are the segregation of the capital of the company into distinctive numbers, whereas stock is not a segregation, but it is bundling up of shares, usually tradable marketable lots, into multiples of tens or hundreds. Then is the time of issue. Originally, the shares can be issued and the stock cannot be issued originally. Only when the shares are fully paid up, they can be converted into stock. Then is the paid up value. The shares can exist in partly paid up only up till the amount the calls have been given, but the stocks have to be necessarily fully paid up. The nominal value of the shares is denoted as share being of rupees 10 each, 100 each, etc. But the stock is denoted by a lump sum of money, which distinguishes it. Then it's a transfer of fraction. The share cannot be transferred in fraction because it is one small unit which exists for the share capital. Whereas the stocks can even exist in fraction, and also it can be transferred in fractions. After the shares have been converted into stock, they lose their distinctive number. Hence, shares existing distinctive numbers, for example, Mr. A holding shares from 001 to 040, that means he is holding 40 shares of company XYZ Limited, but a stock is not denoted by these distinctive numbers. Then is authorization for the issue. The shares can be issued in the normal procedure to be followed by the company, but for the shares to be converted into stock, there has to be an authorization by the central government to convert the shares into stock. Then is the denomination. The shares occur in denominations of tens, hundreds, etc., but there is no such rule for the stocks to be occurring in denomination. Then is the quantum of holding. A shareholder usually holds the shares as he has been allotted, or as the bonus shares are given to him from time to time. But the stocks can be held in money value, which is the converted value of the shares into the stock. Now let us discuss about the conditions for the issue of the bonus shares. Bonus shares are extra shares which has been given by the company to the shareholder. There could be any ratio which the company adopts for the issue of the bonus shares, like 2 for every 5 held, 3 for every 5 held, 1 for every 10 held. So such a ratio could be adopted by the company while issuing these bonus shares. There has to be a specific power in the articles of the company to issue the bonus shares. The sources for the issue of bonus shares could be the undistributed profits. It could also be issued from the securities premium account or the capital redemption reserve. Then is the ordinary resolution which has to be passed for issuing the bonus shares. Also, compliance of SEBI guidelines if the company has been listed on the stock exchange has to be made. The issue has to be done to the existing equity shareholders. The bonus shares cannot be issued to the non-members. These bonus shares are always fully paid up. A partly paid bonus share cannot be issued to any member. Now we are going to discuss another important aspect of getting a membership in a company. This is dealt under Section 41. the subscribers of the memorandum of a company shall be deemed to have agreed to become members of the company, and on its registration shall be entered as members in its ROM, that is the register of members. Every person holding the equity share capital of a company and whose name is entered as beneficial owner in the records of the depository shall be deemed to be the member of the concerned company. Every other person who agrees in writing to become a member of a company and whose name is entered in its register of member shall be the member of the company. Now, this is to say that when originally the company is being incorporated, whosoever signs the memorandum of the company and is the subscriber becomes the member of the company suo moto. And every person who is holding the share capital of the company and whose name is entered as a beneficial owner in the depository account with the records of the company also becomes a member. The third manner is agreeing to become a member of the company through writing. This is through the regular process of share application and allotment. Now, one might say, what is the difference between being a member and being a shareholder? The points of distinction is that the definition of the member is given under section 41 and the shareholder term has not been defined in the entire Companies Act 1956. The meaning of a member is a person who is the subscriber to the share even at the time of incorporation, or who has been entered as a beneficial holder, or who has agreed in writing to become a member. But a shareholder is a person who is actually holding the share. He might not have his name entered in the register of member in certain circumstances. Then is the signatory to the member. A person who is a subscriber to the member becomes the member of the company. When the transfer of share has been done, then the transfer remains a member until such a transfer has been noted with the company. A person who is a share warrant, his name has been struck off from the register of member and he continues to be the shareholder of the company. Now, there are certain modes of acquiring membership, which means how you can become a member of the company. Firstly, it could be by subscribing to the memorandum. Secondly, is by agreeing to take the qualification shares. This is done by the directors under section 254 to become a director. Third is by allotment of the shares. Fourth is by transferring the shares and becoming a transferee of those shares. By transmission, that is by operation of the law. Either it could be the insolvency law, a person dies, then all his shares become transmitted into the legal heir. Then is by becoming a beneficial owner of the shares under the depository system, and by estoppel or acquiescence. When the shares have been allotted to a person and he has not repudiated the fact or disowned the shares, but he agrees to hold them, then by principle of estoppel he becomes the member. Who can be a member, or the capacity to be a member? When the shares have been allotted to a minor, then the following consequences shall follow. Firstly, the minor shall not be liable to pay any calls remaining unpaid on the shares which have been held by him. So the liability of the minor is zero with regard to partly paid up shares. The guardian cannot be compelled by the company to pay the calls due on the shares which have been held by such minor. The minor can repudiate the allotment made to him. The minor shall be entitled to receive back the money which has been paid by him. The company can also repudiate the allotment made to the minor when he comes to know the fact that the shares have been allotted to him. The minor shall be entitled to receive back all the money which has been paid by him. Now, what are the consequences where the minor attains the majority? On attaining the majority, the minor does not automatically become a member in the company. he gets an option to continue with the membership. So if on attaining majority the minor does anything which shows that he has accepted the membership, that is exercising the voting rights or taking the dividend, then the minor shall be henceforth deemed to be a member. During the minority, a company may transfer the fully paid up shares to a minor, provided no further obligation or liability is attached to such shares. So there is no problem in allotting fully paid up shares to the minor, because the liability of the minor is zero in this regard. Now the case of a company, if it wants to be a member in another company. Firstly, a company can become a member of any other company only if it is specifically authorized by the memorandum to purchase the shares of any other company. Secondly, a company cannot become a member of its own. That means a company cannot buy the shares of its own company and become its own member. Thirdly, a subsidiary company cannot become a member of its holding company. So the cross holding between both the companies has not been allowed under the Companies Act. Then is the exception, where a subsidiary company had become the member of the holding company before it became the subsidiary, it can continue to be the member in the holding company, but such subsidiary shall not have the voting rights in respect of the shares held in the holding company. So it will only continue to receive dividend on the shares which it was holding previously before it became a subsidiary of that holding company. The following hold the shares as they are separate legal persons, hence they can become the member of the company. The first one is the cooperative society and a normal society under the Societies Registration Act, and a trade union. Both these entities are separate legal entity, hence they can become the member of a company. A partnership firm, an HUF and a trust, they are not the separate legal entities, hence they cannot hold the shares in their own names. However, the partners can hold the shares in their individual name. Similarly, the members of the HUF can also hold the shares in their individual names. Two or more persons can be allowed to hold shares in a company in their joint names. Now let us know about the position of a foreigner becoming a member of an Indian company. A foreigner can be allowed to become a member of an Indian company provided he complies with the FEMA Act 1999, and in case a war breaks out with such a foreign company, the foreigner cannot enforce any right which is available to the members. The position of the insolvent shall be as follows. The shares of the insolvent shall vest in the official assignee or the official receiver. However, the insolvent continues as a member until his shares are sold by the official assignee or the receiver. So, since his name is appearing in the register of members, he shall be the member, but his share shall be held by the official receiver or assignee until they are disposed of by sale or auction. Until an insolvent is discharged, he cannot become a member. The notice of the general meeting is also given to the official assignee or official receiver, as the case may be. However, the insolvent has the right to vote in the general meeting. So all the compliances regarding to posting of notice and exercising of the voting powers shall be available to the insolvent, because he is actually the member of the company. The position of the government is that if the central government or the state government is holding the shares, then it can become the member of the company. So there is no bar in the government holding the shares of a company. With this, we are concluding our today's session, and in our session today we discussed about the aspects of issuing the convertible debentures into shares and issuing of the loans which are convertible into shares. Also, we discussed about the shares and the stocks, the distinction between both of them, the issue of the bonus shares, and we discussed about the membership, how it can be acquired, and the position of various entities regarding becoming a member of the company. I hope you enjoyed the session. Thank you.